All right, so a bit late to the party, but I just finished up my backlog from the previous season. Been working a lot recently, so a bit slow. So quick rundown of the previous season before we get into the new stuff. New game was absolutely disgustingly terrible, unless you really into like cute girls, and that's all you need, then you're fine, you're set. I dropped it by the second episode. What video game company, what company period, hires someone fresh out of high school who's never done the thing you're hiring them for? What the fuck is that? Berserk, I dropped it before I even finished the first episode. That was so ugly. That was like every, they took the technology to make really ugly background 3D modeled characters from other shows and made them the main characters. It's ridiculously ugly. And a few other shows I ended up dropping late, and I don't normally drop shows late because you're invested by that point. And I'm not saying that all these shows are completely terrible, but ended up dropping Battery, which I was excited for. It kept ignoring baseball for drama, which I was okay with the drama kinda at first. I mean, at first it was sort of all interlinked with baseball, with them wanting to be baseball players and with like the cohesion of the baseball team. But as it ran on, they kept going back to the drama, and before long, it was no longer drama centered around baseball. It was drama of baseball players who'd never played baseball. Sort of the same problem with Cheer Boys, which it started pretty strong. I liked it a lot. And it was kind of obviously a bit sappy, melodrama-y. It was a bit more subtle about it towards the beginning, and then they wanted to have drama, melodrama, really. I shouldn't say drama, melodrama. They wanted to have melodrama every single episode, and they would invent melodrama out of thin air to fill time. I don't need filler, especially not melodrama filler. I must have watched at least 10 episodes, and they only had like one proper cheerleading show. And I dropped Time Travel Girl after about, I don't know, 4 or 5 episodes. It was a neat show. I enjoyed her going into the past and meeting scientists, but then it gets kind of more involved with a dumb plot about her dad and a company, and the I would have been fine if they just stuck to an episodic time travel historical show. Would have been fine with that. The one sports show that didn't fuck up was Days, the soccer one. It wasn't exceptionally great or anything, but it was actually about soccer. Like, that's all you need to do. You need to actually be about the thing. In the art club one, it was trying mostly to be a gag comedy, but it was also very much about the art club and about art more so than normal. Now, for the great stuff of the season, there was well, the one everyone's talking about, Mob Psycho 100. I came into it a bit wary because of the previous show from this mangaka, One Punch Man, which I dropped in a couple episodes I already told you about. It kind of seemed like it was going to be the same sort of deal. It had a similar setup, and the character seems kind of similar, but the character is actually not similar at all. He actually has depth, and the show has depth. You got to sort of stick it out for the first few episodes, which isn't hard to do. They're really well done episodes by themselves. You got to sort of hold on for the story to sort of kick in. And the thing about the story is that the characters are really interesting and have an emotional depth that most anime don't convey. The standout star is obviously the scam artist sensei character who is pretending to be a spiritualist, a psychic who can see ghosts and stuff, but he can't, and he relies on Mob to deal with real stuff. And for everything that isn't real, people coming to him coming to an obvious scam artist with their fake ghost things, he still manages to help them out in his scam artisty way. You know, throws some salt around and gives them a massage and does psychology sessions where he pretends to be their dead father and all of that sort of stuff. And if they're assholes, he gives them a punch. And he's a really great character in that way. Yeah, it's a good show. Other great shows that season were Sweetness and Lightning. I absolutely adored that. That was, it's half cooking show and half a drama about a single father with a widowed father. Is that the right word? Widowed? Can men be widowed? Is that gendered neutral term? And that's a really popular sort of story setup in Japan, at least. I've seen more than a few J-drama and anime about men who have been widowed who are raising a daughter. Like that exact scenario. And they always work really hard to pull at your heartstrings. And sometimes they're cheesy and other times they deliver. This one really delivers because some people watch this stuff and they're going into it with a box of tissues and they want to cry and they're ready to cry and you pull all the heartstrings you want, right? That's not me. You need to put in some effort for me. And I did tear up a few times. And that's because they're very subtle with how they pull at you. And as a cooking show, it is still half a cooking show. It is far better than Shogeki no Soma. And, oh man, that episode where she goes out on her own and they do a whole animation sequence where we're being shown her, like, imaginary world. And then, and of course there was obviously Onura Goro, or there would be, still haven't finished it. Because it hasn't been translated past episode 6. What the fuck? Anime of the year. Finish translating it, please. Please. What are you guys doing? Please. And there was my favorite of the season, translations on Onura Goro notwithstanding, Alderman of the Sky. I didn't go into it thinking I was going to like it because I'm not really big on fantasy. But, yeah, it keeps the fantasy portions sort of very light. Basically, all the fantasy in the show is that there are little fantasy creatures that, for some reason, every person has. Little elemental pet creatures. They don't talk much, so you don't have to worry about the pet creatures being annoying. The main character has a light one, which he uses sort of like as a flashlight and a spotlight. And there's a fire one, which you would think would end up being all Full Metal Alchemist, flame everywhere. It's like a lighter. The elemental magic of fire is a lighter, basically. I saw it used to like light a campfire once, and they use it in sort of inside of machinery as a flame ignition. And there's like a water one, which made ice. That's pretty big deal. They made ice. But overall, it's not very fantasy. It's just sort of pseudo-historical is how I would put it. The story reminds me a lot of the adaptions of the story of Cesare Borgia. Not completely, but the main character sort of shares these similar forward-thinking, scientifically literate attitude that Cesare Borgia does in his adaptions, where the main character is sort of ahead of his time in a world that's ruled by religious royalty. And for both of them, everyone around them would consider them, you know, heretics in some form, unless they're helping them. and overall, the Alderman of the Sky is about, like, war tactics. Once again, a very Cesare Borgia thing. It's one of those shows where, like, Kaiji and One-Outs and other shows I like, where it's very much about the strategy going on, in this case for combat, where the main character has to think on his feet. think up brilliant tactics and you're sort of brought along to be wowed by them. So yeah, I like that a lot. All right, let's get to the new stuff. All Out by Madhouse, good sign. And it's a manga adaption. John Kenji is short and perpetually pissed off about it. Iwashimizu Sumiaki is tall but timid. Although it's bullies that bring this unlikely pair together on the first day of high school, it's the rugby club that will make them friends. So it's a rugby anime. I'm gonna watch it, obviously. I love sports anime, and this is something I've never seen before. I've never seen a rugby anime. Hope it's good. Bloodivores by Creators in Pack Tokyo. 60 years ago, a strange case of insomnia struck the population, forcing them to stay awake for more than a full week. The victims, completely sleep-deprived, all went mad. To cure this illness, a new medicine was produced, but the side effects turned the patients into vampires. Humanity went to war against this new species and triumphed. Alright, hold on. You know what? Fuck the pharmaceutical industry. Everyone has insomnia, and they go to cure insomnia, and they turn everyone into vampires, and then we kill them. We killed a ton of people because the pharmaceutical industry fucked up. Fuck the pharmaceutical industry. Kill them. How about that? Huh. But some of the vampires managed to survive. Born from a human and a vampire, the main character, Mi Lu, the child of hope, is to represent the new hope that will connect the two species. The ringleader of a bank robbery, Mi Lu, is arrested and transferred to a special prison of the National Defense Agency that monitors vampires. Trying to break free with Angie, Mi Lu is attacked by strange monsters, and he finds out that the prison location corresponds to the birthplace of vampires, the old capital, Blue Town. Why are vampires trapped in Blue Town? What are those strange monsters attacking them? Our heroes must fight to solve those mysteries. Sounds shit. Looks shit. Sounds shit. It's an original classicaloid by Sunrise. Story follows high school students Kane and Sosuke, who live in a provincial town that is trying to revitalize itself with music. One day, suddenly, classicaloid versions of Beethoven and Mozart appear, in front of Kane and Sosuke. Classicaloid versions of Beethoven and Mozart. When the suspicious-looking classicaloids play music they call Mujik, fucking retards, it has a strange power. Stars start to fall and giant robots appear. Now every day is tumultuous. Eventually more classicaloids start to appear, such as Bach, Chopin, and Schubert. What is the great power that the classicaloids have? Are they friends or foe to humanity? I'm so fucking confused. So it's ghost composers coming back as mecha robot creatures or something? This is what this is all about. This is why I read synopsises. This is the holy grail of fucking what the fuck. Digimon Universe App Monsters by Toei Animation. They finally made it to apps. They're app tier now, guys. Digimon, I have reached the smartphone generation. You're a bit late. Pokemon actually got there first this time. The key to the anime story are smartphone apps that many people around the globe are using. Inside these apps, all life forms called app monsters, nicknamed Appimon, are hiding. What? They're not even going to be called Digimon anymore? Well, it's called Digimon Universe, but they're Appimon. What the fuck? I kind of want to see this just to see. Like, it could be that it's a new generation. Let's start again with, like, real heart, like we started with to begin with. But I don't think there's going to be any real heart here. This is the millennial version with green hair and smartphone apps. And half the characters are Let's Players. And the other half are people who watch Let's Players. So it's over, man. It's over. Drifters by Hoods Entertainment. It's a manga adaptation. Centers around Shimizu Toyoshiya? The real-life samurai who fought in the pivotal battle of Sekigahara. In his dying moments, Shimizu is transported to a world of magic with other famous warriors throughout history. These warriors are forced to fight each other in an endless battle. Come on, guys. Come on. I don't think I've ever, ever, ever seen an anime or manga about Japanese history that didn't go straight into magic and bullshit and fantasy. They do not know their own history. They have no fucking clue. They couldn't do a historical drama about their own country unless it was in the last 20 years. That is the memory of Japan. I think if you did World War II history is maybe the limit of where they can go, but that's not much longer. Not much longer for World War II history. Soon, Flip Flappers by Studio 3 Hertz. It's an original. How does the world look in your eyes? Papika and Kokona, the heroines of the story, hold the keys to open the door. When the two girls meet, their adventures in a different time and different overlapping dimension called Pure Illusion begin. Many things in Pure Illusion will stand in the girls' way on their search for the mysterious crystal called the Shard of Mimi, an item that is said to grant any wish. However, when the girls find themselves in danger, the Shard of Mimi shines and they are able to transform. The poster is pretty cool, despite the ridiculously massive eyes, but the whole pose and the building perspective and all that. I might try Flip Flappers because it has a cool poster and it's called Flip Flappers. Funwo Amu by Zexus. The series follows the employees at the Genbu Shobo Publishing Company. Araki, who is a veteran editor for the dictionary department, is looking for a successor now that he's approaching retirement age. After Majimi Mitsuya, a salesman who's a poor talker, meets Masashi Nishioka, Araki's co-worker who is sociable and frivolous, Araki overhears their conversation and decides to recruit Majime into the department. The story follows the awkward humans, Majime and Masashi, as they work together to compile a medium-sized Japanese dictionary titled The Great Passage. That sounds really, really fucking interesting, actually. I've never heard of a story about compiling a dictionary. I know a story about some dictionary in, Britain or France or somewhere like that where someone compiled a dictionary while they were in prison. I don't know if that's true or who it's about or why. But that's a story in my head I know about dictionaries. Girlish Number by Diomedia. It's a light novel adaptation, so hold on to your pants. It's a college student, Chitose Karasuma, is determined not to do boring things as she enters the adult world. To this end, this bad-mannered beauty barges into a facility that trains would-be voice actors and actresses, somehow landing a job at Number One Produce. They're stealing my gimmick. You're supposed to call it productions and be normal and dumb. Fucking anime stealing my thing. Seiyu agency managed by her older brother Gojo. In Chitose's mind, she's poised for greatness, but finds herself at a loss when she continues to only get minor roles. That's very voice actor. Yeah, all voice actors think they're fucking hot shit. Fucking hate voice actors. As she clashes with other girls in the agency, including a cunning airhead and a girl with a Kansai accent, Chitose is about to learn that there's more to succeeding in the competitive industry than she imagined. Could be interesting. Doesn't sound like it's glamorizing voice actors, which would be a no-no, because voice actors are not to be glamorized. They're actors who are too lazy to do full acting. They think, it's like acting, but I only have to talk. That'll be easy. Haikyuu has a third season. I'm watching that, Haikyuu. Hey Bot! ! By Bandai Namco Pictures. It's an original. The anime takes place on the screw-shaped island country of Nejigajima and follows the two Bokya Bots, Hey Bot and the Yurui Prince Neijiru, as they collect different Bokya Neji screws. When the Bokya Bots wear the Bokya Neji screws on their head, they're able to compete in Bokya battles. Battles for who can think up and tell the best jokes. This kind of looks, and the synopsis sounds, like a kid's anime that is actually trying. I kind of even struggle to think of what they're selling. I mean, the poster kind of looks like these are toys or something. It sounds like a fairly original, interesting concept that isn't completely forced. So if I see it around, I will give it a shot. Maybe regain a bit of confidence in that there's actual creativity in children's anime. Idle Memories by Seven Arcs. It's an original. The anime takes place in 2035, where virtual reality technology has evolved enough that people can experience world travel and other live event experiences from the comfort of their own home. Why 2035? We can do that today. In this space, idols perform live events for a worldwide audience. As worldwide popularity of idols performing in VR rooms increased, it's not going to be, I promise you, it is not going to be idols performing in VR rooms. You only need to look at Second Life to understand what is going to be happening in VR rooms. It's a lot of dicks. The Canon Private Academy was established on Beginning Island to train new idols. These idols compete and strive to reach the top of the World Idol League. We'll focus on the six idols who make up two units, Star Ring and Shadow. Sounds fucking stupid. Aizeta, The Last Witch by Ajia Do. It's an original. If I am promised to the princess, then I will fight for her sake. In 1939 CE, the imperialist nation of Germania, I wonder what that's supposed to be, invaded a neighboring country. All at once, the war spread throughout Europe. Question. So I mean, it's very thinly veiled, but you did veil the year with CE, and you kind of changed Germany to Germania. Why did you not also change Europe slightly? You just gave up at that point? You're like, fuck it. And the era was dragged into a spiral of a great war. Then in 1940, Germania's attack turned towards the Principality of Eilstadt, a small Alps country abundant with beautiful water and greenery. If the title, The Last Witch, is actually means the anime is going to be about a witch during these faux historical war periods, then it sounds quite a bit like that other anime. Can't think of the name of it right now, but it was about a witch who didn't like war, and she went around stopping combat with her magic, even though she wasn't supposed to. I'll give this a shot, just based on that previous show, which is probably a terrible way to give this a shot. Holy shit. Keijo! Exclamation, 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 exclamation. I think I possibly said too many exclamations. I lost count in there somewhere. By Zebek. It's a manga adaptation. Kaminashi Nozumi, 17, is an exceptional gymnast, so much so that colleges with some of the best gymnastic programs are trying to recruit her. Unfortunately for them, she has other plans. Due to her family being extremely poor, money is everything to her. That's why she wants to step into the world of keijo. Keijo is a type of gambling sport where girls stand on a small floating platform and compete against one another. The aim is to push the other contestant off of the platform into the water, but they are only allowed to use their butt or breasts to push the others off. Will Nozomi be able to compete in the intense world of keijo and bring wealth and fortune to her family? That's great. That's, yeah, I'm gonna watch that. I mean, it's got everything I like. It's got gambling. It's got, sumo butt warfare. Kiss Him, Not Me, manga adaptation by Brains Base. K. Serinuma is what you'd call a fujoshi. When she sees boys getting along with each other, she loves to indulge in wild fantasies. One day, her favorite anime character dies, and the shock causes her to lose a ton of weight. Then four hot guys at school ask her out, but that isn't exciting to her at all. She'd rather see them date each other. This sounds very feminist. Not even like the Fujoshi stuff. The plot point in there about her getting hit on after losing a ton of weight. That's sort of just pointing out how sexist guys can be, I guess. Being far more concerned with your aesthetic beauty than the fact that you're a creep who wants to make guys be gay for your own amusement. Long Riders! By Actus. It's a manga adaption. The manga follows Amy Kurata, a first-year college student with no special qualities. One day, she happens to notice someone riding a folding bicycle, immediately falls in love with it, and uses all her savings to buy one. She eventually gets introduced to the world of long-distance bicycling and road racer bikes, and she forms a cycling team called Fortuna with four other female college students from the same school. Their goal is to ride in a brevet, or long-distance event, called Fresh. So it's another cycling anime, and this time with girls, so it'll probably do even better than Yoimushi Pedal. Or worse, I don't know. Who controls anime now? I have no idea. Is it the Fujoshi or the Moe Moe? I have no idea who controls the money in anime anymore. But apparently we're going for Yoimushi Pedal with girls. So I like Yoimushi Pedal, and maybe I like this. I certainly love bicycles. Who doesn't love bicycles? Magic of Stella by Silverlink. It's a manga adaption. Story follows Tamaki Honda, a first-year high school girl who joins a somewhat peculiar SNS boo circle that makes doujin video games. Huh. It's another girls making video games show. It at least sounds better that it's about high school amateurs rather than high school students getting hired by companies. They've at least sailed over that very small hurdle of believability. Magical Girl Raising Project by Lurch. It's a light novel adaption. A social game called the Magical Girl Raising Project allows one in tens of thousands of people to be a magical girl, possessing extraordinary physical capabilities and looks, as well as special magical powers that set them apart from the rest of the human race. But one day, in a district containing 16 magical girls, the administration announces that it must have the numbers of magical girls to solve the problem of magical energy. At first, the 16 magical girls race to collect more magical candy than their competitors, but the rules quickly become twisted, and it quickly becomes a murderous battle for survival among them. That escalated quickly. Sounded pretty stereotypical until that last line. March Comes In Like a Lion by Shaft. It's a manga adaption. Ray Kiriyama is a 17-year-old boy who recently started living alone, financed by his salary as a professional shogi player. Despite his independence, however, he's yet to mature emotionally, and his problems continue to haunt him in his daily life. His relationship with his adoptive family is strained, and he has difficulties interacting with fellow high school students. Meanwhile, his professional career in shogi has entered a slump. Burdened with the heavy expectations placed upon him, his wins and losses are fluctuating as his record and progression into the ranks begins to stagnate. Acquainted with Rei and the three Kawamoto sisters, Akari, Hinata, and Momo, unlike Rei, they live happily in their modest home, which they warmly welcome Rei into as if he were one of their own. He frequently visits the family, interacting with them and receiving the kind of care and affection he never quite had while under his foster home. This is the story of Rei's triumphs and failures, relationships new and old, and his growth as a person. So this kind of sounds like stories, fiction and nonfiction, about like chess players. Sounds like it could be good. It's obviously more drama-focused than shogi-focused, so it seems like they're following that whole paradigm from the West. That title, March Comes In Like a Lion, I'm thinking that's probably a shogi reference. I don't know if there's like a lion piece in shogi. Nanbaka by Satelite. It's a manga adaption. Four men are assigned to the prison Jugo, a man who attempted to break out of prison and ended up extending his jail time. Uno, a man who likes to gamble with women. Roku, a man who likes to get into fights. And Nico, a man who likes anime. Nico is obviously in jail because he pirated his anime, which is, as everyone knows, a life sentence. You wouldn't pirate a car. Poco's Udon World by Linden Films is manga adaption. Sota Tawara is a web designer working in Tokyo. When he visits his family's udon place in his hometown, Kagawa Prefecture, he discovers a young boy. Upon confronting the boy, Sota soon learns his secret and decides to quit his job in order to take care of the boy. The daily adventures of the two slowly unfold as Poco energetically navigates his way through Kagawa, the Udon Kingdom, along with Sota. You can't just find a boy and adopt him, dude. That's not on. That's not kosher. That's not halal. That's not Christian. Scorching Ping Pong Girls by Kinema Citrus. It's a manga adaption. Ever since their champion was defeated, the world of girls' junior high ping pong has been in turmoil. Koyuri is the new smirking transfer student at her junior high, Bakemono, and she's ready to shake up girls' ping pong. I'm always wary about the sports things when they're technicolor hair girls. This is probably going to end up being garbage, but hey, it's another ping pong anime. Tiger Mask W by Toei Animation. It's a manga adaption. It's fucking Tiger Mask. If you don't know Tiger Mask, it's about a wrestler in a tiger mask. In the Tiger's Hole, wink, the behind-the-scenes organization of the revived wrestling world, two young wrestlers take a stand. One of those fighters has inherited the training facility and mask of a tiger that Naoto Ito left at the floor of Mount Fuji. The other fighter has been victorious at fierce competition since entering the tiger's hole and has obtained the black tiger mask. A tiger mask that walks down the path of light and a tiger mask that walks down the path of shadow. Neither of them have ever seen each other's face in the ring. The two are fated rivals, but their goals are the same. Crush the tiger's hole. All right, come on, guys. That got so Fujoshi at the end. Come on. You're both tigers. No crushing the tiger's hole. Time Bokan 24 by Tatsunoko Productions. It's an original. The anime centers on Tokyo, a junior high student living in the present time who is suddenly made a member of the 24th Century's Space-Time Administration Bureau. Immediately, he learns that the history he has learned in the textbooks is wrong. His textbooks are from Japan, where all the history involves magic, so, I mean, yeah, it's wrong. And there's a more interesting version of history where the peerless beauty Cleopatra is actually the cosmic duo of Cleo and Patra. Momotaro is more of an ogre than actual ogres. Together with his teammate Karen, they use the 24 Bokan Mecha to search for the true history. This is a kid show about history again. And this time they're just like, fuck it, we're just gonna fuck history the fuck up. Fuck any real history. We're just gonna go through time and just fuck the fuck out of history. We're gonna make sure that all Japanese kids grow up all wrong. The Matrix theory is correct. Everything started right now. History's all made up. Token Rambu Hanamaru by Dogakobo. It's a video game adaption. The year is 2205. The historical revisionists have begun attacks on the past in their plot to change history. I fucking told you guys. I told you. The Saniwa, who have been charged with protecting history, can imbue life into objects. Strongest among these are the token dashi. The story centers around their cheerful lives. Can imbue life into objects? I don't trust you with protecting history. If you're gonna do fucking magic, you fucking weirdo creep propaganda machines. They're definitely in the Matrix. Trickster by TMS Entertainment. It's an original. It is the 2030s. The Boy Detectives Club gathers under Kogoro Akechi, the mysterious detective. The group solves cases, great and small, using their unique skills. One day, a member of the club, Kensuke Hadazaki, meets the boy, Yoshio Kobayashi, Kobayashi's body cannot die due to the effects of the unidentifiable mist, but he yearns for death and shirks from contact with other people. This is about Keanu Reeves. We're continuing this Matrix trend. I'm going with it. Taking an interest in him, Hanazaki invites him to join the Boy Detectives Club. Their meeting is connected to the fate, tying together Kogoro Akechi and the era's greatest villain, the Fiend with 20 faces. That sounds pretty dumb. Pretty dumb. Vivid Strike! By 7Arcs. It's an original. Raised up in the same orphanage, Fuka and Rin were once close friends but parted company after a quarrel ended up with Rin overwhelms Fuka with her martial arts skills. Fuka has a life of poverty after leaving the orphanage. An accidental encounter with renowned martial arts champion Einhard Stratos discovered Fuka's hidden talent in fighting. Einhard offered Fuka a job and coaching, encouraging her to meet up with Rin again in a ring. Really, anime? We're gonna make orphans fight? That's fucked up, man. Yuri! On Ice by MAPPA. It's an original. Yuri Katsuki, who carried all of Japan's hopes on his shoulders to win at the Grand Prix finale ice skating competition, but suffered a crushing defeat, returns home to Kyushu and half feels like he wants to retire and half feels like he wants to continue ice skating. With those mixed feelings swirling inside him, he confines himself inside his parents' house. Suddenly, the 5-time consecutive world championship ice skater Victor Nikiforov appears before him, and along with him is Yuri it's another language that I can't say the names of. Plisetsky, a young Russian figure skater who is already defeating his seniors. Victor and both Yuris take up the challenge on an unprecedented Grand Prix series. So anyone who thought Yuri on Ice was going to be lesbians on ice, sorely disappointed. But me, I'm kind of sounds like it's might actually be about figure skating, and that's not something I've actually seen that much about. So, could be good. I'm interested, at least. And now we've got shorts. Let's see if there's any good shorts in here. Uni the Blue Monster by Studio Dean is a video game adaptation. The Al Oni, the animation television series, will be a comedic take on the original story with the familiar characters drawn in super deformed style. I don't know what any of that is talking about, but that's creepy as fuck. Cheating Craft by Blade. It's an original. University exams are one of the most influential factors in one's early life. Depending on the results, a fantastic, high-class, honorable life may await you, or on the other end of the spectrum, you may be left only leftovers. I'd like to point out that that is all bullshit. You run your life. If you want to run it into the ground, you do it your damn self. Don't blame a test. I mean, if anything's going to decide your life, it's not going to be a test. It's going to be the fact that you were born into a rich family or a poor family, all right? Because, I mean, you know, economic mobility. In this type of battlefield atmosphere, students are always doing their best to evolve and survive. Learning types are students who have studied hard their whole lives and legitimately memorized everything they have studied, while cheating types are those who, as the name suggests, only manage to climb the educational ladder by cheating. Though sometimes they must cooperate with each other, there is a great rivalry between the two types. How will the hero Mume, a C-type, that would be a cheating type, followed by the heroine Koi, an L-type, struggle in those tests? Now a new battle, one beyond imagination, is about to begin. This sounds overly dramatic for a short. Like, this synopsis is all dramatic, but it's probably just gonna be some dumb gag comedy. I don't know. I like anything that's about cheating, though. Cheating is an interesting topic. Gakuen Handsome doesn't say who it's by. They're probably already ashamed of that. It's a video game adaption. Baramon High School, a private boys' school for the prefecture's most elite. The protagonist transferred into the school and meets various major players on campus, such as the outlaw teacher, the soccer captain, and a childhood friend whom the protagonist has not seen in 7 years. The school presents opportunities for friendship, love, and conflict. The tagline of the game is, "Whenever you exited the school gates, you were handsome." But I think I must have seen art based on this game because I have seen these fucked up, ridiculous faces. And I love how crazy and dumb this stuff looks. They're like really badly drawn kaijis. Miss Bernard Said, period, by Creators Impact Tokyo, manga adaption. The short gag manga is about the love of famous works of literature. It follows Sawako Miss Bernard Machida, a lazy girl who wants to be a well-read person, but does not actually read much. Hey, that's me. The manga recounts the conversations between Miss Bernard and her bookworm friends about the Bible, the tale of Heike, guns, germs, and steel, the door into summer, the great passage, Fermat's last theorem, and more masterpieces that she has not necessarily read. To Be Hero, all caps. It's an original by Emon. Handsome, divorced, and with a teen daughter living with him, our hero is a bad father who works as a toilet seat designer. One day, as he was in the toilet, he found himself sucked into the toilet seat, and he is given the important task to save the planet. The price for being a superhero is quite large. This good-looking guy is transformed into an ugly dude with superpowers. To protect the Earth and his daughter Min, his fight is about to begin. Ellipsis. Yasumuro yasasi no yasasi seikaki something si. An original by DLE. This series follows a mysterious but gentle-hearted man named Yasahi Yasumura, who spreads warmth and human kindness wherever he goes. So that's the anime. Go watch the anime. And buy Social Interaction Trainer when it comes out on November the 3rd or 4th or whatever. Or you can buy it right now on itch.io.